Good morning. Let's open our Bibles to Acts chapter 20 together. And there ought to be, Mark has green handouts going around. So if you'd like one, wave Mark down. He's graciously passing those out for us. So we're in Acts chapter 20 together this morning. And this is a expositional series we've been going through in the young adults class. So we're just picking up with the next passage. But I figured by way of introduction, just to refresh you, since not all of us have been walking through this together for the past several months, I would say just a couple words of introduction about the book of Acts. First of all, Acts chapter 1, verse 8 is really an outline for the book. It's where our Lord commissions the apostles for their mission right as he's about to ascend into heaven. And the Lord says this to the 11 apostles, "But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you," referring to the day of Pentecost, "and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the end of the earth." And so, as I said, and as you're probably familiar with, this functions as an outline for Luke for the unfolding story of the book of Acts, so that beginning in Jerusalem, the apostles receive the Spirit of God on the day of Pentecost, begin preaching the gospel as his witnesses there in Jerusalem, and then it expands outward in concentric circles, really, throughout the book of Acts. And where we're at this morning, entering into the story at Acts chapter 20, is as Paul is on his way back to Jerusalem. He's been arrested and converted to Christ by the Lord. The Lord saved him out of a life of sin and sent him as an apostle and a witness to the gospel back in chapter 9. And we've been watching him throughout the chapters, going on a first journey out from Antioch and back, and on a second journey out again and back. And now he's really bringing his third, what we refer to as his third missionary journey, to an end. And towards the end of that ministry, he spent 3 years in the city of Ephesus. And there in Ephesus, in Acts chapter 19, verse 21, Luke tells us that Paul resolved in the Spirit to go to Jerusalem and then to Rome thereafter. And so that's really the last part of the story. He's taking the gospel to the ends of the earth, to the city of Rome. And on his way there, he's going to Jerusalem. And so that's where we're entering into the story. We meet him now in Acts chapter 20 on that trip from Ephesus to Jerusalem after he's already passed through the regions of Macedonia and Achaia, or Greece, for the sake of encouraging the churches there. That's the beginning of chapter 20. And after encouraging those believers and administering the word of God to those in a city called Troas, which is where he spent 7 days, and you'll probably remember that he preached through the night, and a young man, well, a boy named Eutychus, fell asleep and fell out of the window and died, and Paul resuscitated him, and it was a great encouragement to the believers there in Troas. Well, now he has gone on from there. Paul and his companions have made their way to a town called Miletus, where we find them here in Acts 20. Now, the voyage from what is referred to as Chios to Samos to Miletus would have put Paul very near to the city of Ephesus, actually, where he knew many dear believers. He spent the better part of three years there ministering among them, and he was dear to them, and they likewise were dear to him. Many of them had come to know the Lord for the very first time, saved out of a life of paganism through his ministry. We might have expected him, therefore, to have stopped in Ephesus to pay a visit to them while he's on his way to Jerusalem. But instead, what we find from Luke's note in Acts 20, verse 16, was that Paul decided to sail past Ephesus, to skip over visiting the believers there, so that he might not have to spend time in Asia. It would detain him and he really was hastening, Luke says, to be at Jerusalem, if possible, on the day of Pentecost. Paul knew that if he stopped in Ephesus, the visit would require more time than he was able to give under his constraint from the Spirit to be in Jerusalem as soon as possible. But even so, Paul had some crucial dealing to do with the elders of the Ephesian church. And so rather than stopping over in Ephesus while he sails past south to Miletus, he summoned the Ephesian elders to himself while the ship was docked 30 miles south of Miletus. 30 miles south of Ephesus in the town of Miletus. Okay, so all that's introduction. Our text consists of Paul's address to these Ephesian elders when they meet him in this town of Miletus. And so to summarize this for you before we read it, Paul's example of watchful shepherding in Ephesus, his example, set a pattern for the Ephesian elders to follow so that the flock would be guarded from the forthcoming wolves, the threats that are coming at them. And so we'll see as we read this in verses 18 through 21, Paul's example of watchful shepherding, and in verses 22 through 35, before the parting with the elders, we see Paul's exhortations to watchful shepherding. So let's read together. Acts chapter 20, verses 17 through 38. Now from Miletus he sent to Ephesus and called the elders of the church to come to him. And when they came to him, he said to them, "You yourselves know how I lived among you the whole time from the first day that I set foot in Asia, serving the Lord with all humility and with tears and with trials that happened to me through the plots of the Jews. How I did not shrink from declaring to you anything that was profitable and teaching you in public and from house to house, testifying both to Jews and to Greeks of repentance toward God and of faith in our Lord Jesus Christ. And now, behold, I am going to Jerusalem, constrained by the Spirit, not knowing what will happen to me there, except that the Holy Spirit testifies to me in every city that imprisonment and afflictions await me. But I do not account my life of any value, nor as precious to myself, if only I may finish my course and the ministry that I received from the Lord Jesus, to testify to the gospel of the grace of God. And now behold, I know that none of you among whom I have gone about proclaiming the kingdom will see my face again. Therefore, I testify to you this day that I am innocent of the blood of all, for I did not shrink from declaring to you the whole counsel of God. Pay careful attention to yourselves and to all the flock in which the Holy Spirit has made you overseers to care for the church of God, which he obtained with his own blood. I know that after my departure, fierce wolves will come in among you, not sparing the flock. And from among your own selves will arise men speaking twisted things to draw away the disciples after them. Therefore, be alert, remembering that for 3 years I did not cease night or day to admonish everyone with tears. And now I commend you to God and to the word of his grace, which is able to build you up and to give you the inheritance among all those who are sanctified. I coveted no one's silver or gold or apparel. You yourselves know that these hands ministered to my necessities and to those who were with me." You can just picture Paul raising up his hands, the ones that crafted tents, to make a living as he's saying these words. "In all things I have shown you that by working hard in this way, we must help the weak and remember the words of the Lord Jesus, how he himself said, 'It is more blessed to give than to receive.' And when he had said these things, he knelt down and prayed with them all. And there was much weeping on the part of all. They embraced Paul and kissed him, being sorrowful most of all because of the word that he had spoken, that they would not see his face again, and they accompanied him to the ship." So we see, first of all, in verses 18 through 21, after the introduction in verse 17, Paul's example of watchful shepherding. Paul reminded the Ephesian elders of the ministerial pattern that he set for the elders while he was with them. His reminder focused on two major characteristics of his ministry among the Ephesians. First of all, a constant and earnest presence with the people characterized Paul's ministry among the Ephesians. Paul's presence with them was constant. From the beginning to the end of his time in Asia, he lived among them. And Paul's ministry was earnest. He served the Lord among them with humility and with tears. And the trials from the hostile Jews there in Ephesus did not sway him from his task. During the first 3 months that Paul spent in Ephesus, he preached in the synagogue, reasoning and persuading the people about the kingdom of God. And in verse 9 of chapter 19, Luke writes, "But when some became stubborn and continued in unbelief, speaking evil of the way before the congregation, he withdrew from them and took the disciples with him, reasoning daily in the hall of Tyrannus." So after switching venues to the lecture hall of Tyrannus, Paul was with the disciples daily, ministering to them, fulfilling his duty to the Lord by administering the gospel to them, even with tears, he says. And the hostile opponents in the synagogue could not thwart the earnestness with which he ministered the word of God to these dear believers. An earnest and constant presence with the people characterized Paul's ministry among the Ephesians. And secondly, both public and private teaching of God's word characterized Paul's ministry among them. Most of his public ministry was in this lecture hall, this public venue there in Ephesus. And that's where, as I say, most of his ministry happened. But we see here that Paul not only ministered the word of God publicly, but also privately, from house to house, he says. Paul's public and private teaching was geared toward the profit of his hearers. He withheld nothing from them that would help and profit them in their walk with the Lord. And he solemnly witnessed to the nature of true conversion as part of what Luke is focusing on in the content of Paul's teaching as he's among them. He says in verse 21, he's testifying both to Jews and to Greeks of repentance toward God and of faith in our Lord Jesus Christ. Repentance and faith are two sides of the same coin. One does not have saving faith if he has not repented of his sins. Neither does one have true repentance if she does not believe. When only one is mentioned in the book of Acts, and I would say in Scripture, in the New Testament broadly, either repentance or faith, the other's always implied. But they're both beautifully side by side in Acts 20, 21. The image of repentance portrays a sinner, in this case, one of the pagan Ephesians, turning from his or her idols to the living and true God. And in that turning to God, the sinner sees his or her guilt and helplessness to do anything about it. And at that very moment, again, repentance and faith go hand in hand. At that very moment, the sinner sees Jesus Christ and embraces him alone as the only Savior from divine wrath on account of sin. Having received the mercy of God in Christ and having turned from the life of sin, the believer determines by faith to make a definitive break with the old way of life and with the sins that characterized it. The Ephesians demonstrated this kind of conversion, dramatically so, when they had a public book-burning session in the city of Ephesus. In verse 19 of chapter 19, Luke wrote, "A number of those who had practiced magic arts brought their books together and burned them in the sight of all." These are new believers, publicly, dramatically repenting in a costly way. They counted the value of them, that is, the books that they burned, and they found that it came to 50,000 pieces of silver. These people formerly trusted in this magic and in this pagan worship for protection from harm, for blessing and prosperity. They trusted in these things. And so burning them publicly is a dramatic way of demonstrating this definitive break with their old life and their former objects of trust that could do for them something. They were looking to them anyway to do something for them that only God in truth could do. Now, granted, not everyone's conversion is going to appear this dramatic from external human vantage points. I don't think mine would, personally. But that does not render the conversion any less true and real. Faith and repentance. Repentance and faith. That's true conversion. And that was an integral feature of Paul's teaching in Ephesus. So not only was Paul's ministerial example among the Ephesians characterized by an earnest and constant presence among them, it was also characterized by both public and private teaching of the Word of God with an emphasis on true conversion. Now, having turned their eyes back to his own example, Paul begins in verse 22 to turn their eyes forward as he applies these lessons. So Paul's exhortations to watchful shepherding are found in verses 22 through 35. The elders must follow Paul's example because of the coming threats. Paul was leaving, never to return to Ephesus. He revealed to them the fact that we who have been reading the book of Acts already know. He was headed for Jerusalem. And although he didn't know what would happen to him, except that persecution and chains awaited him around every corner, he still went because he was bound by the Holy Spirit to do so. This is an important detail and somewhat of a poetic one in the book of Acts. Jerusalem is the very place where we first were introduced to a young man named Saul as he oversaw the stoning of Stephen. But as Saul was going out from Jerusalem to Damascus like a ravenous predator, that's how Luke describes him in chapter 9, he's breathing threats and murder against the church. That's when the Lord saved him. On the road to Damascus, Saul became Stephen's brother, Stephen, whom he stoned. And by the time you get to Acts 20, Paul has been chased around by his Jewish antagonists in practically every place he's gone. And now, having set his face to go to Jerusalem, he might see the very same fate that Stephen saw in the same city. The former hunter of Christians may very well become the hunted Christian in Jerusalem. Now, when the Lord saved Saul, he said, "I will show him how much he must suffer for my name." And now Paul says that the only thing he knows for certain as he looks toward his destination is that imprisonment and affliction await him wherever he goes. None of this deterred him. None of it deterred him from pressing forward because he was a man with a Christ-like value system. The Lord taught us, "If anyone would come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. For whoever would save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for my sake will find it." And you see that in verse 24. Paul says, "I do not account my life of any value, nor as precious to myself, if only I may finish my course and the ministry that I have received from the Lord Jesus, to testify to the gospel of the grace of God." The one thing that mattered to Paul was that he make it to the finish line of the course that the Lord had set out for him, which was the mission to be a witness for the gospel of God's grace. What can anyone do to a man with that kind of value system? One thing mattered to him, to fulfill his duty to the Lord. Didn't matter what happened to him. No one could stop him. The prospect of chains and affliction were no deterrent for him, so he would go to Jerusalem. But this meant that he would no longer see the Ephesians. In fact, in verse 25, lest the Ephesians hold out hope that he might swing by on future journeys, Paul said, "I know that none of you among whom I have gone about proclaiming the kingdom will see my face again." They were on their own in the sense that Paul would no longer be personally present with them. But they were not without help. Paul set an example for them to follow, and that equipped them for future faithfulness. So the Ephesian elders needed to follow the pattern that Paul had set for them. And we get some restatement of what we've already seen in the first section of his speech. But next we see that faith and faithfulness and comprehensiveness in his teaching characterized his ministry among them. His ministry was faithful, he says, beginning in verse 25. His conscience was clean. He left nothing unsaid that ought to have been said. Now, we've already seen Paul do this once back in chapter 18, but Paul is here likening himself to the prophet Ezekiel, and specifically in verse 26, when he says, "I testify to you this day that I am innocent of the blood of all." In Ezekiel chapter 33, the Lord illustrated the responsibility of the prophet to a watchman on the wall of the city. If the watchman saw a threat coming and blew the warning blast of the trumpet, then he did his job faithfully. Even if someone failed to escape, their blood is on their own head. The watchman did his job. However, if the watchman failed to blow the warning blast when he saw a threat coming, and even one person died, the Lord would require the blood of that person at the watchman's hand because he failed to do his job. And the Lord applies that to the prophet Ezekiel in verses 7 through 9 of chapter 33. He says, "So you, son of man, I have made a watchman for the house of Israel. Whenever you hear a word from my mouth, you shall give them warning from me. If I say to the wicked, 'O wicked one, you shall surely die,' and you do not speak to warn the wicked to turn from his way, that wicked person shall die in his iniquity, but his blood I will require at your hand. But if you warn the wicked to turn from his way, and he does not turn from his way, that person shall die in his iniquity, but you will have delivered your soul." That's the Lord's words to the prophet Ezekiel. Paul, when he says, "I testify to you that I'm innocent of the blood of all," is asserting that he himself is like Ezekiel and sees his duty and his responsibility as an apostle and as a preacher like that of Ezekiel. Paul was a watchman for the house of God as an apostle. And by extension, so are the church's elders. But Paul knew beyond a shadow of a doubt that he was faithful. He blew the trumpet loudly, the trumpet of the gospel. He blew it loudly and clearly. That's what he explains in verse 27. "For I did not shrink from declaring to you the whole counsel of God." If Paul had not proclaimed the whole will of God, but only part of it, then he would not have been able to say that he was innocent of their blood. This would mean that he would have failed to proclaim a teaching essential for the salvation of his hearers. But as it is, Paul could say that he was a faithful watchman. If anyone perished under his preaching, it would not be because he failed to sound the trumpet loudly and clearly enough. He faithfully proclaimed every feature of doctrine essential for salvation. The trumpet blast of Paul was clear and comprehensive. He announced the whole counsel of God. He was a faithful watchman. So then, the whole counsel of God in verse 27 refers to the comprehensive teaching of God's will as it is revealed in his word. And this, of course, is why we do our best to stress the importance of consecutive expository teaching and preaching in the life of the local church. And also, along with that, the importance of systematic theology. That we would be a people who are familiar with and conversant in the whole counsel of God. And Luke's recorded example of Paul's preaching like this is found in chapter 13. I won't turn there, but you can go read it later. It's this long account, 40 verses or something, of this sermon from Paul in Pisidian Antioch in the synagogue. And in that sermon, Paul preached about how the resurrection of Jesus Christ proclaimed forgiveness and justification for believers and warned scoffers of judgment. And all of this in fulfillment of the Old Testament scriptures. He's tracing the line all the way from Abraham to Jesus Christ and pointing forward from there to salvation and judgment. It's really an amazing sermon to read and to study. Paul clearly showed both Jews and Greeks the way to salvation from wrath and the way to forgiveness and justification by faith in the crucified and risen Lord Jesus. He proclaimed the whole counsel of God faithfully. He was a faithful watchman, and that was a pattern for the Ephesian elders to imitate. And now Paul is going to shift from the imagery of a watchman to that of a shepherd. And this shift is really very natural. It's an easy one, because a shepherd is a kind of watchman. Thus, in order to be faithful, he must pay careful attention both to himself and to all the flock. That's verse 28. A major motivation for elders to carry out their responsibility of watchfulness over the flock is that the Holy Spirit is the one who has appointed them to this task. The Holy Spirit, of course, uses means to appoint the elders to their office. He stirs the desire within them. He equips them with the spiritual gifts requisite for the task. And he makes all of that obvious through a man's visible life in the context of a local church and the existing elders and the body of Christ coming around that individual. The Spirit of God uses means to appoint elders to this task, and yet, nonetheless, Scripture affirms that it is the Spirit of God himself who is doing this when it is done in accordance with biblical standards. Paul binds the consciences of these elders to the fact that God is the one who appoints them to this office. And God is the one to whom they are accountable. And the Holy Spirit appoints them for a purpose, to care for, to shepherd the church of God. The elders of the churches are accountable to God for who has called them to this work. And they are accountable to carry out the purpose for which he has called them to it. They're called to shepherd the church, that is, to lead, to feed, to protect the flock of God from harm. So one motivation is that it's the Holy Spirit who has appointed them to this task, and another major motivation for them in their work is that the church belongs not to them, but to God, who has paid the highest price imaginable for it. God purchased his church with his own blood. Now, some translate the description of the church of God in verse 28 to be which he obtained with the blood of his own, implying his own son. That's the New English translation does, and that's a possible translation grammatically. But many throughout church history have taken it to be something equivalent to what you probably have in the New American Standard and the ESV has, which he obtained with his own blood. Now, since we know from Scripture that God is spirit and does not have a body, as John Calvin wrote, Paul is commending in this verse the unity of the divine and human nature in the person of Jesus Christ. We confess that there are two natures in the one person of Christ. In the fullness of time, God the Son, eternally one with God the Father and God the Holy Spirit, condescended and took a true human nature to his divine nature so that in his person there is a union of two natures. He is truly God and truly man. And as Calvin continued, Paul attributes blood to God because the man, Jesus Christ, who shed his blood for us, was also God. This is an amazing verse. It's enough for many sermons and many hours of reflection to be spent upon. And I would commend that to you. Could there be any more powerful motivation for the elders of the church to do their job faithfully? The church belongs to God. It's his treasured possession. What a responsibility. And notice part of the elder's responsibility is to pay careful attention not only to the flock, but also to himself. Personal watchfulness is an essential feature of the elder's responsibility. Now, Paul is about to direct the elders about the threats that the church will face from within and from without, but it's fitting that he first addresses the elders themselves. Before looking to threats external to themselves, these men needed to take stock of their own lives and commit themselves to ongoing personal watchfulness. Paul repeats the same exhortation to Timothy in 1 Timothy 4:16. Keep a close watch on yourself and on the teaching. Persist in this, for by so doing you will save both yourself and your hearers. So the elders are to keep a close watch on their doctrine, that it is sound and true, and they're to keep a close watch on their lives, that they're holy, that no secret sin crops up unaddressed. In fact, one sin, if I may skip to verses 33 through 35, just as an example of one thing that elders need to pay careful attention to in their own lives, is the sin of covetousness. It's what Paul addresses specifically in this passage. I coveted no one's silver or gold or apparel, Paul writes. You yourselves know that these hands ministered to my necessities and to those who were with me. In all things I have shown you that by working hard in this way, we must help the weak and remember the words of the Lord Jesus, how he himself said, it is more blessed to give than to receive. It's entirely inappropriate for the elders to spin a large profit off the backs of God's people so that they are burdened. The elders were to guard themselves against coveting the things that would cause this kind of burden on God's people. And the best way to guard against coveting, Paul is addressing, is generosity. That's what Paul did. Unless Paul received support that was voluntarily given to him by one of the churches, like the Philippians, they did support him, and he gladly accepted it. In fact, one of the main purposes of his letter to the Philippians that we have is to say thank you for the gifts that he's received from them. Unless he received them from them, he worked as a tent maker for his sustenance. He did this so that he could help the weak rather than to be a burden to them financially while he was trying to minister the gospel to them. Paul set down this example of helping others by working hard, which illustrated a saying of the Lord Jesus that it is more blessed to give than to receive. That's the mentality that these Ephesian elders and all the servants of the Lord must take up. It's not an unqualified statement. It's not that it's wrong for elders to receive an income from their labor in the gospel. Scripture's clear. But instead, it's a safeguard against the sin of covetousness. Paul teaches elsewhere that it's wrong to muzzle an ox while it's treading out the grain. And on this principle, he says in 1 Timothy 5:17, let the elders who rule well be considered worthy of double honor, especially those who labor in preaching and teaching. The point here is that the elders needed to be focused on the needs of God's people and to trust the Lord to provide the things they needed. And the way that they are to shepherd the church of God is to pay careful attention to themselves and to all the flock, specifically as it's vulnerable to predators. And that's where Paul goes next. These coming threats demanded alertness from the elders. I know that after my departure, fierce wolves will come in among you, not sparing the flock. And from among your own selves will arise men speaking twisted things to draw away the disciples after them. So there are external threats and there are internal threats. Those coming in and those uprising from within, Paul is saying. So the elders needed to stay alert by remembering Paul's pattern of exhortation. These men knew Paul well, and that's why they needed to stay alert by remembering him as he truly was and his teaching. Now, facing Paul's words about these threats might have been disheartening to these elders, and it can be for us as we no doubt think of the threats that we face in our day. It could be overwhelming, and it might tempt the elders to fear, but there was no solid reason for the elders to fear. Even in the face of threats, the elders and the members of the church need not fear, because our Lord said, it's an unqualified statement, I will build my church. Matthew 16, verse 18. There's no reason to fear these very real threats because ultimately the preservation of the church depends on God. And that's the encouragement Paul gives them in verse 32. I commend you to God and to the word of his grace, which is able to build you up and to give you the inheritance among all those who are sanctified. Ultimately, there was nothing to fear. Paul did not fear for them, but commended them to God and to his powerful word. When the elders are committed to that word, ministering under its authority and by its power through the Spirit of God, they are safe from threats. It's the word of God that he uses to build up his people and to give them the inheritance that he has promised to them. And so with this, in closing, Paul departs, and there are many tears shed. It's a very affectionate meeting, which is just a reminder of the intimate relationships that we share in the body of Christ. Now, as we close this, I guess, could be seen as a passage that applies only to those who aspire to be elders or who are elders. And it certainly does. This is a text that I know our elders and anybody who's thinking about Christian ministry looks to, along with other important passages of Scripture. But I would urge you, as you think about this text and what it teaches, to take these high standards and to use them to pray earnestly for our elders. Pray for them. God has blessed us with faithful men to set an example for us and to lead us and to make important decisions. And I thank God for them, admirable men by his grace. It is a real gift. They need our prayer ongoingly. When you look at these demands, pray for them. And also another practical conclusion from this text for all of you is to know who you are. Know who you are. This is a great description of what the church is. You are God's blood-bought church. To be the church of God, which he obtained with his own blood, is to be God's chosen and holy covenant people. To be obtained by the Lord is to become his treasured possession among all peoples through his new covenant. It's to be a people for his own possession, a people for his name. Know who you are. Embrace these things. We exist ultimately, and the primary reason we've even assembled here this morning is for God, for his glory, to magnify his name. It's what we exist for. We are a people for his name, obtained by him, for him. Meditating on this truth causes love for God and gratitude to him to grow. It's also a motivation to pursue holiness. As Paul said, you are not your own, for you were bought with a price. So glorify God in your body. 1 Corinthians 6:20. So let's go from here with a fresh determination to pray and ask God's blessing on our elders. And let's go from here knowing who we are as God's treasured possession because of who he is and what he has done for us in his Son and Spirit. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for sending your Son for us and for our salvation. Thank you for obtaining us for yourself by his blood. Thank you for sending the gift of your Holy Spirit to unite us to yourself and lead us in this great restored communion and life in the new creation. We thank you for our church, for our elders, these men that you've given to us as a gift. I pray for them that they would be encouraged in their work, that they would hope in you, and that they would put their confidence, as they already do, that they would continue to put their confidence in your word and your Spirit to accomplish your will in the world and in our midst. And I pray for your blessing on this next hour as we go. Help us to magnify your great name. Would you be glorified in our midst. In Christ's name, amen.